Welcome, everybody. This is an awesome experience for me every time I come on campus, but this is definitely coming full circle. I sat in this class, I think about 27, 28 years ago, and I've watched Dave do some incredible things with this class. I know it's clearly the most popular class on school. I know it's hard to get into. This afternoon, I was leaving the house to come out here, and my kids were asking me where I was going in a suit. And I said I was going back to school. And they said, like Rodney Dangerfield? And I wish. But nevertheless, I'm here, and it's really terrific. Dave, thanks for having me. Thanks for having Skip and John. So in a few minutes, you're going to see a video. And the video is going to tell the World Panel story. I think it's a great way to introduce you to a person and a technology that is going to change the way people live around the world. And I'm not really talking about people in this country, but I'm really talking about people that are living off the grid, the electrical grid, living the bottom of the pyramid. The other night we had a blackout in Studio City. 9 o'clock, all the lights went out, and my kids were like, oh my God, what are we going to do? My iPhone's only got 3% on it. And so I started to use this as an opportunity to say, you know, do you realize that there's billions and billions of people around the world who every day their biggest challenge is just keeping their phone charged? And so today you're going to hear an incredible story from John Anderson, done and portrayed on the video that you're about to see, that's going to talk a little bit about this game-changing technology. But, you know, what I wanted to do before the video comes on, I wanted to kind of share with you how this formidable team, this partnership came together. Skip Brittenham, as Dave alluded to, is a very private person. He has built arguably the most successful entertainment law firm in the world. Whether you want to measure that by their clients or you want to measure that by their revenues or their per earnings per partner, it's off the charts. And it's because they're very passionate about what they do and they bring tremendous value to their clients. And Skip is not just an attorney, he is a consummate deal maker, having done some of the most high profile deals in entertainment over the last 20, 30 years. Whether you want to talk about Pixar, DreamWorks, or talk about some of his clients, whether Oprah Winfrey, Harrison Ford, Ridley Scott, the list is long. But Skip doesn't really talk about it. But what he's really passionate about is the environment. And if you go Google Conservation International, you're going to learn about the most prolific nonprofit dedicated to the environment. And Skip has raised billions of dollars for this organization. So when I was learning about World Panel a few years ago, I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, you know, who would be strategic for John to meet? And as I was sitting there, it came to my mind that there's really one guy. And so I started to talk to Skip a little bit about this company. So we set up a lunch. And I think I'd rather be, you know, I guess, more lucky than good. I think maybe I was a little bit of both here, because what Skip has been able to deliver and bring to this company is not just capital, but tremendous brain power and tremendous strategic relationships that have really changed the face and the direction and the trajectory of this company. It's hard to create what we call a triple bottom line company. There's a lot of well-intentioned people that are trying to create products that are going to help the planet, going to empower people, and maybe make some money. But unfortunately, the reality is that these companies need to make money to be sustainable. So you could be the most well-intentioned person in the world, but your product has to sell, it has to be distributed, it has to get to the people in need, it's got to be sustainable. So John Anderson, as you're going to learn today, is an incredibly passionate person who has a very interesting background as an entrepreneur, as a professor. Today, he's brought all of his resources together with Skip's guidance and counsel. They're doing some amazing things. I kind of look at this as the mentor and the mentee. Skip was instrumental in the early days of Steve Jobs. He was providing Steve and the company with a lot of guidance. Today, his student is John Anderson. John Anderson is very, very sharp. He has created and developed microcell technology that is changing the world, but with Skip's guidance, you're going to learn that this company has an incredible opportunity. So with that, let's go to this video. Enjoy, and we'll pick up from there.
Please welcome John Anderson and Skip Brittenham. That is so powerful in 6 minutes, you know, with every business, and you probably didn't go out to start a business. You went out to solve a problem and to probably find a solution for people that need it. Give us your why. I mean, really, like, your personal why of why this is so important to you.
Well, thanks for having me, and I'm humbled, and I'm grateful. You know, it's really what I'm supposed to do on this planet. It's not something that I set out to find a better mousetrap than somebody else. It's not that I was trying to prove that I was better than people. It was really a search for, you know, what my purpose was. And it's true. I mean, it took a long time for me to find it. Some people, like Mr. Brittenham, have a very early sense. But for me, I took some years. When I went to Africa, I was asked to help people with cooking. And when they asked me to help them with their phones, it was this calling from beyond. There was a lady there named Beatrice, and she had kids, and she had no energy. And her phone was dead 4 days a week, and she couldn't call, and she couldn't get water, medicine, food, connect, get a job. And she came to me with her big brown eyes and said, "Will you help us?" You know, I never had that sincere of an ask in my life. No one had ever really asked me that sincerely. And I realized with all the skills I had, with solar and business and intuition, that it was a calling for me to do this. And so, you know, the why comes from purpose, and it comes from mission, and it comes from heart space. I'm an emotional guy, and I have a heart for people. That's why I'm in the triple bottom line company. You know, I'm building an organization that isn't, you know, business as usual. It's not a take, make, waste organization. It's an organization that's good for the world, good for people, and creates financial returns, right? Because we need an economic engine if we're gonna have a positive impact in the world. It can't be a donor market, and everybody wanted to buy this. And as an entrepreneur, I looked around and I said, oh my word, there's a lot of customers. So, you know, my focus switched instantly from looking at people as destitute, looking at people as poor, to looking at people as customers. And when I looked at this large group of customers, my respect level went way high. And I needed to make sure that I created a technology. Or if I ever did create a technology, I just wanted to send them something that they could count on, something that was good, something I'd feel proud of. And I look at all those people in this show and on this screen as my customers. And I want to provide my customers with a good product that lasts, that's useful, that improves their life, just like anybody that you buy products from want the same thing. So when you look at this majority world, it's 4 billion people that live on about $2,000 a year or less, but that's 4 billion customers. It's not 10 million segmented customers that Procter & Gamble is looking for or some big corporation. It's a huge market. So there's entrepreneur energy, there's doing good energy, and there's environmental integrity energy here about trying to help people and help the planet. You know, we're on a collision course with the future, and that isn't looking so promising when we see the droughts that are going on. In fact, the front page of the New York Times today talked about droughts in Africa. In Zambia, where I was there visiting, and the reservoirs are down 90%. So all the hydropower is getting cut off in Zambia. So, you know, we have to be kind to the planet. And, you know, modern day corporations in America, you know, really, I hope, as World Panel can provide an example for, can actually drive financial returns at scale and do good in the world. So doing well by doing good is what I'm trying to do. And so that's where it came from. It came from like a life's mission.
You're gonna feel it. And that's, you know, normally there'd be small talk and banter to start, but coming off that video, it's just too powerful to like start with a joke. And, you know, everything about what you want to do starts with why. And, you know, what do they say? A man with a why can get through anyhow. And so, Skip, you know, we're going to talk about how your relationship evolved, and we're going to talk about the product very soon. We're so excited to see it work. But what was your why?
Well, when I met John, as you can tell, he had a lot of passion, and he really believed in his mission. Although I must say he had a product I thought sucked. You know, he had this big thing like this, and I said, John, I want to join this mission. I want to help these people. I looked at it like, well, if it failed, it's like giving money to a charity, trying to do good things. But I said, this big thing you have, I don't think that's a commercial product. And he said, but Skip, when I go into the villages, I get mobbed because they want electricity. And I said, yeah, if you went into a village, they were starving, and you had a bowl of fruit, you're going to get mobbed, right? You're the only source of food, sustenance. I said, but you're not selling the guy in the village. You're selling the guy in an air-conditioned office in Johannesburg. He's got to want that. And I said, so I think we have to redesign this product to make it much more commercially viable. And you say that to some entrepreneurs or inventors, and the first thing they say is, see you later, alligator. I don't want to be in business with this guy. John thought of it, you know, I think you're right. Let's do it. Which, by the way, led to well over a year, probably a year and a half, a back and forth between the two of us just on product design. And we went from this big thing like this to this panel you see or will see like this that can fit in your pocket that's almost as fast as a wall plug that I think has broad application. And I also said to John, I'll join in your mission, but I want to build a business. I don't think you can actually reach that many people unless you actually turn this into a real business where people are motivated and making real money. So we have to be a game changer for the mobile ecosystem. We have to be the solution to the 2 billion people that have phones that don't have any access to electricity. We got to be able to provide it at a cost. And he and I, that was the beginning. And I think we had some further conversations. But what I love about John, I love about the way our relationship works, is it's also about the best idea wins. And it's also about iterating and trying to do things better. And it's also about providing the best value. I'll just give you a very simple example. We have this battery that we sell for $10. We were buying the battery for $6. And the $6 battery would last for about 2.5 years, which for batteries is not so bad if you understand the battery business. John calls me up and he says, I found a better battery. It costs $7, so we reduce our margin from 10 to 3. Reduce it by a buck, but I think it's better for the consumers and I still want to sell for $10. I said, great, let's do it. We didn't have any, there was no further discussion because we both wanted to do the right thing by the customer. And I truly believe long term, if you're building a brand, that's what you got to do. You got to service the customer and their needs first, and the economics will follow and take care of themselves.
It's so interesting to hear how you guys, you know, how they came together and sort of the commonality. If you get 10 minutes of Skip Brittenham's time, and there are people all over the world trying to get a meeting with him, and they will go through desperate measures, and you have this person as your partner and an advisor, it's something that he obviously believed in and believed in you. So, you know, I'm sure it was a combination of the person, the passion, and the product, but it sounds like it was a lot of the person. Congratulations for...
Well, yeah, when I started, there was no business model. And I didn't know if there ever would be one. We had no patents, no branding, no deals, no manufacturing, and a product that I didn't think worked.
And a crazy guy in his garage.
And a crazy guy in his garage with a lot of passion.
All good stories start in the garage, don't they? With people that just believe, you know, no matter what you tell them, they just like, you just don't understand. If you understood, then you would be with me.
Well, the truth of the matter is, you asked this right before this, you know, why didn't some electrical engineer do this? Why didn't, and I instantly said, You have to not understand the limitations of solar technology. One of my best friends is, one of your friends has huge, is in the
he
solar business.
He spoke in class. Yeah.
Yeah, one of our investors and friends ran ARCO's solar business for 15 years. It was the biggest solar company in the world at the time. And the whole solar industry had decided that you cannot stream electricity through panels and control the amperage and the voltage without a chipset or a circuit board or an inverter, converter, something. And the course of adding that element to control the amperage and the voltage, on the big commercial panels, you lose about 25% of the power. On the mobile panels, you lose 50, 60, 70% of the power. They had all decided you can't do it. So no one was trying to do it. John thought he had a notion in his head that he could do it. And he went in his garage, spent 2 years and his life savings trying to do it till he did it. Now, the truth of the matter is, most people, most of these stories when people do this, guess what? You really can't do it. Common wisdom is right, you know. This was an instance where he thought out of the box and he just kept going no matter what. I asked him once, actually it was when I was at the factory, I said, I was talking to him and Matt, the other guy you saw in the video that spent all the time doing this. I said, you were broke. When were you gonna stop? He'd mortgaged his house. When are you gonna give up? And he basically said, I was never gonna get up. I was just gonna find a way to make money and keep going, right? So I think John's particular genius at seeing a way to do this, but also his mission that drove him made him get to a point where he actually created something quite unique. And by the way, 99.9% of the solar business don't know we exist yet. You know, although we're getting inquiries now from all over the place. We just launched a couple of weeks ago. We've been very deliberately, very low key about the technology and everything else. So I think it took a unique person who was on a mission. If you're just chasing money, you'll never get there. I don't believe in chasing money. I believe in chasing ideas you believe in.
I would say it's kind of a rare experience too for me because, you know, I wasn't trying to set a record or break, you know, the power algorithm. I was essentially just trying to help people. And we ended up breaking into a new field, you know, so there was a social mission that drove it. But, you know, we did it kind of the way Wright brothers flew a plane, is we basically failed the experiment. It took me 240 failed experiments to make a panel that I would send to Beatrice, right? Over 2 years, I get up out of bed. I didn't care what time it was when I went to bed. It was just full focus to try and get this panel. We'd fail the experiment, and we would just throw it in the bucket, and we would try another one. And we wouldn't document really what happened and all the materials and what happened. You know, we just, like I said, it's not working, try another one, it's not working. And it took time, and we got smart with all the failures, right? But one day, it worked. And it was just really keeping your head down. Skip talks about being under the radar. And it really is, keeping the head down, not coming out of the closet, just fully focused on this every day. It was like Michelangelo painting, you know, on the basilica. It's like, what time is it? I don't know, I'm painting, you know, that's my life right now. And that's what happened thanks to Brian and, you know, some of the A money that came in to help me stay in the garage. And I did have some early successes with energy and streamed, you know, little stutters of streaming, but never could make it consistently work. And so we were able to raise money on that. And I have a utility patent from the United States for doing this. USPTO gave me a utility patent. It's 9,088,169 is my number. So I can't believe it.
You guys know what a utility patent is?
Yeah, explain what that is. Yeah,
well, there are three fundamental kinds of patents. One is design patent, which is what it sounds like, which I've always discounted, although Apple just won $4 billion from Samsung based on
a design patent.
On a design patent. And there's something called wraparound patent, which is taking various things that have been patented and putting them together in a new way. That represents well over 90% of the patents issued. A utility patent is something brand new, something no one's patented before in whatever area it's in. So it's kind of a breakthrough. There aren't many these days, to say the least. So we have about 20 plus patents, but the only one that I care about is utility patent.
Great. Well, you've talked about the product. We see it there. We're dying to sort of see it work. Is it real? Can you touch it? Can you show us how it works? Can you take us through it a little bit? Well, let's start with the product and the technology. Oh, I am loving these colors.
So I need a volunteer. Would you come up here?
Yeah. By the way, this is ambient light. This is not sunlight. I just add one thing. You take any other panel sold and you try to do this in this light, nothing happens.
So here, would you hold this panel?
Sure.
And it fits in your hand?
Yeah.
Yeah. And there's a little light plugged into this thing. It's just a regular LED stick light. If I plug it into this panel, you can see the light is on, right?
Yes.
Now, put your hand over the panel. And what happens to the light?
The light goes off.
Okay, and take your hand off.
I feel like this is a magic trick.
So, what's your name?
Natalie.
Natalie. So, Natalie, you're making your own power right now.
That's pretty cool.
Instantaneous power.
Instantaneous. So, this is the most efficient solar panel in the world. It takes light and converts it into electricity at a 99% throughput rate. There's nothing in between the cells and the light. So it just instantaneously takes light, even fluorescent lights in here. And the sun, this thing is powered like a wall plug. So if you have this with you and you plug into it, you're free from the wall plug. You don't have to carry a house to be mobile. You think you're mobile with your phone until it's dead, and then you gotta find a house to plug into. This right here literally keeps it free. So you can see it's working real?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Everyone can see how this works?
There's no storage. There's no storage device.
So straight pass through.
I mentioned that battery that we sell with this, and we sell this LED light. You can get about 10 hours of light from the battery, from one charge of the battery.
This is a battery, okay? And this holds, this will charge your iPhone one time. You just plug it into the panel, and this will store the sun's energy for you. So, but all our flashlights, all our batteries have a really bright flashlight because it's dark, there's no light in Africa. And then this, if you plug this into the battery here, you have light for 10 hours at night. And then, you know, you can hang this up and have energy at nighttime in your house, okay? Now,
We sell the battery for $10, the light for $5, this panel for $20. So for $35, you have power, stored power, and light.
Yeah, keep your phone powered or store your energy. When I went to Zambia, I went to a rural hospital where there is no energy, and the doctor used this light to perform surgeries, like this. Okay, can you imagine that? So the sun is powering villages and hospitals, and World Panel technology is leading the way.
You said that was
99% throughput.
Yeah. So explain what throughput is in efficiency, in layman's terms for me.
Well, amperage, voltage and amperage, think of it as a hose. And the pressure pushing the water through the hose is a voltage, and the amount of water passing a particular point is the amperage. So what we do is all of the other panels need something to control the speed of the water, keep it steady, and in the course of doing that, the mobile panels lose at least half of that power, speed and power, voltage, amperage. John's system, since there is no chipset, since there is no circuit board, it passes straight through. He's found a way to control and stream the amperage and the voltage, control it with no chipset or circuit board. That's the magic sauce that he discovered. So not only is it much more efficient, way more efficient, you can see it works in this light, it's way cheaper to manufacture because the most expensive part of mobile solar is the chipset, right? The most efficient thing. And it's way more durable, so I can take this SC Colors and do that, right? if it was UCLA Colors, I wouldn't have done that.
Those are fighting words around here, brother.
It's much more durable. You can put it in water. You can drop it. We've dropped it from 300 feet from a helicopter, just as a demo. because in Africa, and it lasts. This is designed to standards that will last 20 years. The normal mobile panel that you buy for anywhere from 120 to 150 bucks will last for 30 to 40 charges. So he's come up with something that's, it's only time in my lifetime I've ever seen this, and I've done a few deals, where something is a better product, more durable, and way cheaper. Not a little cheaper, way cheaper. You know, a fifth or less of the price. That doesn't happen. And it fits into the mobile ecosystem, the fastest growing part of consumer electronics. Like in India, for every 24 phones, there's one computer. You know, your phones, well, everybody forgets. Okay, let me ask you a pop quiz. When was the first iPhone, first smartphone? 2007. That's right. It was in 2007, okay? Think about that today, how many smartphones there are. A smartphone is now a computer. It's not about chips anymore. We've reached, Moore's Law no longer applies. Smaller, faster. The reason is we've reached the limit on smaller, which is called the size of an atom. You can actually make a transistor now that's the size of a light wave, okay? So you can't get any smaller. You can get a little faster, but not at the same rate. So what's happened is your phone is a computer, and you crunch everything up in the cloud. So that's changing everything. So if you have a phone, a smartphone, and you know how to use it, you can do all the things you used to need a computer to do. And so what we're trying to do is educate and enable literally 2 billion people and bring them into modern society. That's what we're trying to do.
And the if you've traveled to, you know, Africa, India I don't know as well, Africa I know well, I was in Uganda, and, you know, this is a way to sort of really catch up. You know, they're not going to build schools as quickly, they're not going to build infrastructure, but if you, they're cellular. And by the way, in Uganda, there's better cellular coverage in, I was in the Bwindi impenetrable forest with gorillas, and my guide is getting, his ringtone was the Bengals. But to hear that go off, and it's better service that I get in Manhattan Beach. I get cut out, you know, near the ocean. So there's coverage everywhere. They may not have electricity. They may not have a lot, don't have plumbing, don't have toilets, but they have cell phones. So this really is that paradigm shifting opportunity to catch up. And, you know, it's, I think the only comp is, you know, water, you know, in terms of utilities and what you're bringing. So it's faster, it's cheaper, it works. There are detractors who don't believe it. And so, you know, you're welcome to tweet at the end of this about, but the facts and things like that, that we'd have the confidentiality policy in here, so let's not put it out there. But there
we don't have it. We don't have any detractors that have tested it. We're in business with the four biggest players in Africa. You know, the biggest phone company, they tested it. Massmart, which is a Walmart sub, they tested it. You know, we deliberately slowed everything down because I wanted to be sure the company went out with the best companies, with the branded companies, because there is a problem with mobile cellular, which is it doesn't work. So we want to be sure we went out with the right people. But nobody that's used it detracts from it. Some people, I was up in Silicon Valley about a month ago, meeting with some people, and one of them asked me about this, and he was a guy who specializes in energy, and he said, that can't be true to me. He invests about $3 billion annually in energy. And I said, well, guess what? It is true. He says, show me. I said, I can show you, but I'm not going to. Show you later, you know. After we launch, you can see it. But it because there is such a belief system that it can't work and you can't do it, the industry itself just assumes, you know, we're like them. You know, we're somehow rope-a-doping everybody, okay, even though we're not. Although it won't be long. I mean, we've had inquiries, 150 companies, something like that now. The word is getting out very, very quickly, because as soon as somebody gets one of those panels in their hands and they use it and they see it works and they see how long it takes to use it, And we're, once our data run is completed in the next 2 or 3 weeks, we'll have very profound data about how every one of these solar systems works versus the wall plug on various phones versus us. So we'll have the hardcore proof. But the people, you know, as soon as MTM figured out it worked, the biggest phone company, they said, hey, we want it. They're bundling it with minutes. Because the biggest problem the phone companies have in Africa, place out electricity, is people don't use their phones because they can't charge them. And what they sell is prepaid SIM cards. It's not like our country where everybody just has AT&T or Verizon or Sprint or whoever, and they just pay a monthly bill. There they buy SIM cards and put them in. So they change carriers all the time depending on who they can run in for the SIM card. So what, the average African in these areas only turns on their phone less than half the month. Less than 15 days a month they turn it on because they're preserving their power. And I think we said that if they want to charge their phone, they have to go to a kerosene-powered a generator, and it costs them 50 cents. And we've been told frequently the people running those don't even let them get 4 bars. They kick them out after 2 bars. So you got to schlep there, wait in line, pay 50 cents. This is 20 bucks. Math is pretty simple when it starts paying for itself, right?
It is like the water problem. You spend so much of your day going to get water. You spend so much of your day going to get your phone charged.
Going to get electricity.
Yeah, that right. You're not going to get, you know, you're not going to have a job, you're not going to be productive for your family, you know, whatever you can do in terms of child raising. So I think your closest comp is water or utilities. Mm.
It's a necessity. It's a basic in life. It's a new basic. You know, you have your, I don't wear a wrist watch anymore. I have a phone, right? I mean, and so.
They don't even know what that is.
Yeah, so you have no watches unless it's fashion, you know? And so, you know, everything is getting dematerialized, which is good, you know, into one device. You know, there's not as much of everything. So, but when it comes to electricity in the villages, like you saw, I need to call if my baby gets sick. I need to call my sister. Well, if her phone's flat, then she can't call her sister. But it's the same with water. If they have the phone operating, they can call for water. And so it is literally at the very bottom of necessity. It's a basic need to have electricity. And the UN has called it a human right to have electricity. The only thing is the grid is not going to make it to the world, and there's 4 billion people that suffer every day, and literally 2.2 billion people that have no electricity at all. It's amazing to think about it. Right now, the sun is going down here, and the sun's coming up in Africa, and there will be thousands of citizens that get up, come out of their grass hut or their tin roof, and they'll put the panel out and they'll charge their phone and they'll walk to work and they'll call and they'll their schools, their jobs, their families, because they're making their own electricity. Who in here wants to make your own electricity?
Get off the grid, yeah.
Would that be cool? Make your own electricity, and it's good for the world and it's free, right? And so these people could kind of see the future, you know, that we can't see, because like Skip said, I don't have an electrical engineer degree, and if I would have, this wouldn't be here. I happen to be a guy who's a photovoltaics guy, works on solar technologies, and so I was able to bypass traditional methodologies. But it's the same in the sustainability world. People who live on subsistence, people who get up every day and you know, make $2 or $3. And look, they're as industrious as this class. David, I mean, there are people that work as hard as we do every day, but they just happen to be in a circumstance where they can't profit as much. This here changes their lives. Now, listen, you hear about Facebook and Zuckerberg and everybody, the new buzzword is connectivity. You know, first there's networks, and the land grab in Africa is over, all the towers are up, and there's no major mountain ridges. It's almost all flat, so every 50 miles in Africa, there's a cell tower. And every cell tower is standalone, 24/7 fail-safe. It doesn't go down, whether it's diesel or it's renewable energy, it keeps them going. So the network's there. The next thing's devices. Devices in Africa are very small percentage of smartphones. A lot of feature phones, very basic phones. Might have a Facebook app, WhatsApp on there, and a phone number, mobile money, which is another innovation that's coming out of here. But you know, what is really necessity for them is content. You know, the content that you have access to is also available in Africa. And so when you talk about connectivity, you know, Facebook's going to connect the world. We've heard this, right? And it's a noble undertaking. And we see Google with balloons shooting down internet and
drones shooting down internet, and we have upgrades on the towers. But at the end of the day, if you don't have this, the networks are not being utilized. So this is an ecosystem boost. It's basically plankton in the ocean. It's a mobile-enabled energy consumer. So a consumer that's mobile-enabled with their energy. And so these Beatrice and Luwazi and Spiro and Joseph and Jacob and all the people I know in Africa that walk around with a panel literally are leapfrogging us here because they just make their own, you know, like, oh, I need some energy. Here, I got some energy. You don't need energy. You know, I got my own energy with me. And so isn't that kind of what you think should happen anyway?
Also, from an environmental point of view, most people don't know this. Every time you charge your phone, you use it takes a half a pound of carbon to create that energy.
You guys know that?
Did you know that?
If you take everybody in here, every day, your phone is full of coal or gas or CO2 because you plug it in the wall and that's what goes into it. Yep. And so there's a lot, it's a lot every day you're carrying a whole bunch of carbon on you.
So, and it takes about 2 months of charging every day to pay for the energy it took for us to create this. And then it's carbon neutral, it's reducing the carbon footprint. Right. One of the things we're working on is an app that'll tell you how fast you're charging and how much carbon you're saving and everybody else is saving. Start adding it up. Because we think there's an environmental component of this too. I mean, I think there, my point of view is, and this is personally me, I think there are three forces shaping the global economy and shaping the future of the human race. One is globalization. One is tech, and the other is the impact that we are having on our environment, how we are impacting nature. And I think this device has a positive impact on all of them. In terms of globalization, it enables people that otherwise wouldn't have a chance to join modern society. In terms of tech, it is a breakthrough tech. And by the way, there are a lot of other things we can do with this tech, obviously. And in terms of nature, it reduces the carbon footprint. So to me, I think this falls right into the heart of what's important today in terms of helping both the economy and the human race.
And that's sort of what we
thought. That will end it. No, sorry.
and that's what we talked about. Ben Vandenbont opened our series, and he's big in renewables. And it's observing large trends, right? Macro trends. So he just talked about three or four different trends converging and why they all support this. You know, an entrepreneur doesn't try and like force something up a hill. An entrepreneur looks for something that's really already in motion, that there's momentum behind you. And so all these forces just add up to why this thing can really accelerate. It's the carbon neutral part of it. You know, he talked about just the manufacturing, and there are plenty of things manufactured that are much more intrusive on our environment than that panel. That's the goal for here. You know, Americans are probably the least concerned with the environment. You know, and least concerned about the impact of electrical usage. But you know, right now you can't put solar panels on your house and take the energy from the top of your house to your house. It has to go back into the grid. So imagine how much loss you're having, sending it to there, and then maybe getting a credit on your bill. So he's doing in miniature, in individual portions, what we need to do at our houses, at our schools, everywhere. So it has broad application beyond this.
First step, it's the first step into participating with the environment. If you charge your tablets, charge your smartphones with the SunStream technology, then you have sun in your phone. You have no carbon in it. And that repeated over a lifetime makes a significant difference. And it's also distributed. The technology we have, every single person can have one, and you don't have to have a house that faces south with the roof and all the metrics right to even get solar or put it in your yard. I mean, so it really gives you a chance to personally contribute and feel good. I mean, you go get your Starbucks and you take the cup and throw it in the recycle bin, or you throw it in the trash. If you throw it in the recycle bin, you feel good, you're doing your contribution, it's not painful, and that's how this technology is too. It's good for the world, it's good for you, it's good for what's ahead of us. Another thing I'd like to say is, I was fortunate enough to teach at the University of Denver for a couple years, and
We talked about what creates a sustainable enterprise. And, you know, when you look into the future, how are you talk about carbon and what's ahead of us, you know, how are companies being sustainable? Well, you know, the two modern theories are companies need to somehow embrace clean technologies. How is an organization embracing clean technology? So the clean technology doesn't have to be renewable energy. It can be some kind of clean tech. Case in point would be that the Dreamliner is less carbon per mile traveled per person. So they're saving weight, they're adding more cargo, they're making it more efficient, they're working in clean technology. So the second component about what a company needs to be sustainable in the future is how do you serve the base of the pyramid, the 4 billion people in the world that make $2,000 a year or less. And that's a huge marketplace. And we can see that coming about with companies like Google and Facebook that are going to add, you know, a billion customers through, you know, in India, for example. That's their marketplace. So when you think about business, how do you be sustainable? Think about clean tech. Think about this huge consumer base that's looking for products and services that are the underserved, that are the majority world. There's the hurdles are lowered because they're so open to new to people offering them something because they never really have been noticed. So, you know, that's a Dow Jones Sustainability Index, you know, is another case in point is if you're going to borrow, you know, if Costco or anybody's going to borrow hundreds of millions of dollars from Dow Jones for their money, they're going to pay less if they qualify for the Sustainability Index. So as you, future leaders of the world, look at what you're doing, what I'm doing is an example of what can be done with guidance from Skip and what we're building is we look like a nonprofit, but we're a for-profit. So it's called convergence on capitalism. How are we looking to do good and do well? You know, when you think about, for example, YMCA, what are the revenues of YMCA?
Memberships.
So it's $4 billion a year, right? But they're a 501c3. They're a nonprofit, but they're acting like a for-profit, okay? They look like a for-profit. They feel like a for-profit. Goodwill, same thing. They're trying to look like a for-profit, but they're a nonprofit. So in order for a nonprofit to be sustainable, they need to take on elements of capitalism. And for capitalism and for-profits to be sustainable, they need to take on elements of nonprofit, and that's what World Panel represents, this convergence of a new business model.
It's perfect. I don't know how many people are here from, so we have a program here for social enterprise called the Brittingham Social Enterprise Lab, not the Brittingham, the Brittingham Social Enterprise Lab. Anyone here from that classes? All right, good for showing. And the whole, yeah, up top.
You just have to need it. Change a few letters.
Yeah, and write a big check, and we could change that. But the point of it is that it's not about examining charitable models. You know, the raise, spend, repeat cycle, which is brutal. You know, we're all involved in charities. But this is how do you create business solutions to solve world problems. And it's something that's very important at USC, and I think we're one of the leaders in it. So this is, you know, just a perfect message and a perfect thing, especially for this generation because, you know, our generation, you know, we got out of school, we're like, okay, it's our time. We got to make some money. You know, let's go to law school. Let's go find a business. And there's part of that with this generation, but they also get it earlier that it's sort of not just about how much, you know, pulling all the chips off the table into your own lap the whole time. They're impatient. They don't want to, like, go work in a cubicle without a purpose, but they want to do some good things. And so, like, this type of business is, I mean, it's what we all look for. Is you know, we don't expect you to be nonprofit. We expect you to make an obscene amount of money because you're solving a problem, and people will pay. You know, even people where this is a percentage of their income, their monthly income, they will pay because of the value. And you know, the unique thing about this stuff is everybody in this class can attest to it, is that once you're on a device, you have no chance not to be addicted to it. They're, oh, yeah. You know, the best psychologists in the world at Facebook and Google and everywhere else, Apple, you can't win. So you know, your viral marketing campaign will be one person in a village or one person in a town saying, I got this. There'll be a black market for these soon because you can't stop. I mean, I know some people may have checked their devices in here. May have. It's neuroscience. It's biological. So you really are going to have, you know, a viral spread.
I have three daughters. I have a 15-year-old daughter, who I never see without this, without her looking at a device. And I showed her a cartoon, a New Yorker cartoon, that she found very insulting, but I loved, which is two girls laying in bed, staring at their phones like this, and one of them says to the other, you know, I hope the first time I make eye contact with someone is with the right person. And I show her that, and I said, this is you. You know, you're never making eye contact with anybody. Also, what I've noticed, the difference between her and my other daughters, I have two older daughters, is that she is never just on one device. She has her iPhone, she has her computer, sometimes she has the TV, and she's going back and forth. She's talking to somebody on her iPhone, doing something on her computer, and watching TV, which drives me absolutely bananas. But your generation, you know, you just take it for granted that, you know, you're just going to connect with anybody you want to, whenever you want, and all your friends are on Facebook, and you can talk to everybody you want to date, you go on Tinder, you know. I mean, what you can do with a mobile phone today is virtually unlimited, is the point.
Because it is about...
And you think how it changes your life. If someone took away your phone for a month, you know, everyone in this room would be like rubber-legged, right? So think about, you provide the ability for all these people, 2 billion people, to actually use a mobile phone and do all these things that you take for granted. You know, they don't have big social networks in these areas because people can't afford to talk to each other, communicate. They don't want to use their power to do it. So this is, I mean, I think this is going to have a tremendous positive impact, maybe other than Tinder, but for everything else, I think it's going to have a huge positive impact. And also, you know, with micropayments coming in Africa, that's the way to go. Your phone is also your checkbook. You know, you can buy things with it. You can do your bank transactions. You know, you can communicate. You can learn, you know. You can search, you can do all the things you can do, and you know, you guys take for granted, and I take for granted, frankly.
So when we were shooting this video, there we were filming a sunset, and we were in a village in Chongwe district of Zambia, which is in the rural areas, no electricity anywhere for miles. And we had driven on a dirt road for probably at least 50 minutes to get to this rural hospital, and the sunset was beautiful. And we got there in the end of the day, and we were Vanessa Roth was our film director, and she said, let's get that sunset. So she goes out and starts filming the sunset, and a guy in a bicycle, it's a beat-up bike, but he was about upper 30s, 38, 39, 40 years old, comes riding by on his bicycle and said, what are you doing? And she said, we're filming the sunset. He goes, I want to ask you a question. Why does the sun come up on that side and set over there? Why doesn't it come up on that side and set on the same side? And she said, really? The world's round. And he said, no, it's not. The world is flat. I've been to all the edges. And so what do you do when someone thinks the world is flat? I mean, is that really happening? So she pulled out her droid, typed, hit Google and hit solar system and hit a animation and said, this is what the Earth looks like going around the sun. And he said, oh, the world is a soccer ball. And I think that's what you're alluding to here, okay? It's just the power that restricts him. The internet is right there at his fingertips. It was an unbelievable experience to see that. He said that he wanted to get his son an internet phone so that he could learn and get a panel so he can be powered.
It really is. And so let's talk about the product, how you make it, and then distribution, then we'll open up to their questions because I want them to ask questions. You said there was, 240 failed experiments?
Yeah.
So we teach the lean startup model here.
Uh-huh.
You know, get nice. To an MVP. What's MVP stand for?
Minimum viable product. Yeah, that was enthusiastic.
Minimum viable product, you iterate, you get it into the customer's hands, get feedback. Yours was a rapid iteration process just for the technological side without the customer. But talk us through about your philosophy and how you build, how you learn, and how you adapt.
Okay.
And how quickly you can move.
Look, you know, I was trying to achieve a walking wall plug in your hand that fit in your pocket, would work underwater, and was $20 or less, okay? So I could only use legacy materials. It wasn't like I went to the world and said, the world's a blue ocean, it's an oyster, I can use whatever I want, invent whatever I want. What I used and deployed in this strategy was called sandbox innovation. And there's a TED talk on frugal innovation. And so we wanted to make as least amount of materials as we could, and it did an Apollo 13 roughly. We just said we can only use these materials, and this is it. We can't add expensive Texas Instrument technology. We can't add software. We have to just use fundamentals. And by the way, everything we used had to be in existence for at least 20 years. So we couldn't use something that had to be made to make our product. It had to be existing legacy. So it's a legacy materials. And the reason we used that was because it was inexpensive. Everything that's been around for 20 years is inexpensive, pretty much. So we used all these standardized materials, and then we had to start manipulating and conforming to try and build it into a usable energy source. And what we ended up doing was using mathematics. So this puts out 5 volts and about 1/3 of an amp, okay? And it communicates with the phone. So these solar cells in here are semiconductors that communicate with each other, communicate with the light, and communicate with the phone all through math. Basically, we took, what does the phone need? Can we make a panel that matches what the phone needs? And you know, we've been talking about making custom sized panels to any kind of phone you want. And really that's how we did it, was we just dematerialized, we bypassed, we avoided, we restricted, and we had no money to do anything. So we had to work basically at Home Depot, we had to buy really inexpensive materials, and we just kept failing. And we embraced every failure as a victory because we tried. And then we'd say, that doesn't work, we're gonna try this. So essentially it was using existing materials, like what you said, you know, the only thing that changes the world is technology. But it has to be rooted in today's world. You know, it can't be rooted in tomorrow's world or it's not gonna come true. So this is all made of a polymer material. This is an extraterrestrial polymer material called nylon 66 with fiberglass embedded in it. And we took that methodology, is had to be abundant, had to be legacy, had to be cheap, had to be available, and that was what was on the table.
And so, you know, when you met Skip, it was large and ugly and unbranded, and now it looks like something polished and beautiful, and it's got a brand. How are you going to distribute it? What's the business model for your entry strategy that it's in the news, so it's public, right? That these deals are public.
Right,
so explain what's happening and how you're going to distribute this, because it has to make money. It has to be sustainable.
You want me to take a cut at it?
Either way, I'll do it. You can do it.
So I've spent 4 years trying to sell the product that didn't look very cool. I would get mobbed, but then we couldn't find anybody that would distribute it for us. So I really was, would sell to anybody that would want to buy it from me. And I ended up selling a container or two to some distributors that resold it. But it was never like what Skip said, the buyer in the room has to want it. Like, you guys want one. When I go to meetings, they want one. And that's what was the game changer. And we actually, because of the persistence and the word that got out there, we were approached by the number one brand in Africa, which is called MTN. Has anybody heard of MTN at all? A couple people, you have? Yeah, so they have about 250 million SIM cards out in the market, and they're the biggest company for cellular.
Biggest phone company.
Biggest phone company. And everybody you saw in the video, like this son here, he's got a phone, and MTN is a distributor of hardware and airtime. And so we have a rule, we don't talk to anybody unless they have a channel to our end customers. If you have to develop the channel, then we don't, it's a longer slog, so we don't do it. So we just have been able to partner with the number one brand in Africa. Then we have also Massmart, which is the Walmart of Africa, that's approached us because they see that we can make a change, and we're changing the face of Africa. We're leapfrogging this technology. The promise is finally able to be fulfilled, and they're believing, and we're doing pilots, and we're rolling out, and we're being successful.
But once we got the product, and I knew we had a product, once we had this product, we were going back and forth. I have in my office, in my home, all these different products till we got to this product. Once we had the product, I said, basically to John, I'm not going to let you sell it to anybody other than big branded companies. We have to focus on getting the best of the best. This product works. They need it. We got to show it to them. We got to work our way up through the system. They can try it. And once they get it, they'll want it. And so we spent months letting people test it, doing things. I know John was anxious because he wanted to generate revenue. I said, it's much more important to build a sustainable brand than just quickly generate revenue. And it's much more important to get in business with the right brands that are with this product. So MassMart, the Walmart sub, is getting rid of all of those solar products. They can roll this out. We're going to be the only solar product in their stores. MTM is bundling it with minutes now. We have TomTom, one of the best device makers there, is bundling it with their devices. Safaricom, which is the number two retailer and number one in certain countries, is going to sell it. And we want to stick with the right brands. And what we have done, what we've learned, and we've actually iterated back and forth our marketing message, is we now have the message we can give them that sell it. Like in MassMart, we had one signage, wasn't working as good, we switch another one, boom, now we got something that actually works. You know,
that was pretty
charge
fast.
Your phone. Yeah, we did it in like 3 days.
Yeah.
Charge your phone in 2 hours, new technology to explain what it was, new breakthrough technologies, sell your phone in 2 hours. We have people using it so they could see them using it, and mobile electricity, people got the value proposition. But the plan for the future is the same thing, is to be not just take, you know, random orders, but to get in business with people to build the brand. And I think the demand, we know the demand's there. And see, in Africa, I always felt it will take a lot longer to go viral than it would, say, here when everybody's connected, because everybody there isn't connected, and particularly the audience we're trying to reach. But I must say, the sales went like this, boom, 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 boom. And it appears that it's starting to go viral. I said we have to take 2 or 3 months before anybody will really start figuring this out in Africa, and it's been about a few weeks, and they're figuring it out.
You could see where this brings such value. If you're a carrier and you are selling airtime in minutes, and people are using their phone less than half the time,
This is
such an upsell.
Oh.
Where they could eat it and pay for it. You don't even have to pass it on to the customer, yeah. But that could be first. And secondly, now, the customers are going to pay for it.
Yeah, that's right. They're giving away minutes. I mean, MTM thinks this is a game changer for Africa and a game changer for their company. The CEO of the whole company asked John to come meet with them and talk about the strategy and whatever else. But I think the first thing we did, I believe, by the way, that we could charge more than $20. We could charge $25 or $30, really increase our margins, because they have to have it. But that didn't fit our mission. So it was mission first. We're still making money, but not what I believe we could make. Okay. Now as we move into more developed countries with other products,
thank you.
We will definitely change the pricing. But I wanted to first honor John's mission. I thought that was very important, and build the brand. And, you know, there were some scary moments there where we said, gee, well, one of these guys really going to do this, and da-da-da-da. And the good news is, you know, you have to go through a whole process. I mean, the Walmart process to get a vendor number typically takes 6 months. We got it in a few weeks. And then they started stocking it, and they restocked it. They sold out the first carousel, then they got another one, and they placed another order, and it's boom, boom. Now they're believers. Right, but I also think, I believe, maybe I'm naive about this, but I believe in kind of the inherent goodness of people. And I think the people at MassMart, the people at MDM, think they're going to be instrumental in changing Africa for the good. And I think they're very proud of that. In fact, MTM said that to us. They said, we can change our brand and we can be a force that changes Africa and brings value to Africa. And I think they're very proud of that. So I think the confluence of all that stuff, but I'll tell you something, anytime you're doing a startup, you know, there are bumps in the road. I'll just tell them one of the bumps. We've had a few bumps, but we made it through all of them. But we were, John and I were going back and forth about where to manufacture. And common wisdom was you have to manufacture in Malaysia or China. It's the only place we can get that to a price point where we could actually sell it for $12.50. I was scared to death about going to China because a number of my friends that have done business in China say, well, as soon as you show them how to do it, they're going to be moving as much stuff out of the back part of the warehouse is to the front. And once we teach them the technology, they can pirate it. So I decided, I said, we were getting bids and we were debating this one versus that one and who can we trust. And the fact was we didn't really trust any of them, right, John? And I, just by pure happenstance, and this is how I think sometimes you got to be lucky. You know, it pays to be smart, but it also pays to be lucky. A very, very close friend of mine was the largest manufacturer of clothing for Walmart. His name is Mark Feldman. He delivered 1 million units a week to Walmart. He had factories of literally 1 million square feet, bigger than the Astrodome. Distributing, he had distribution centers of 500,000 square feet, okay?
12,000 employees.
12,000 employees at one of his plants, actually. He said, look, I showed him this at lunch, and I said, would you do me a favor and go to our manufacturing plant, take a look at this and give us our advice. We're trying to figure out what to do. And I said, and I mentioned China. He says, oh my God, China. He says, look, I'm the biggest customer for some of these companies and they rip me off every day. You know, they use inferior quality products. They steal stuff. They don't do it right. It's a horrendous problem. He has all these people in China that do nothing but watch the people in the factories. And so he flew in.
To Boulder.
And he says to John, he says to me, you guys are crazy. You can manufacture here. And you can manufacture here as cheap as the bid you're getting in China. And we said, really? Really? He said, yeah. He says, and I'm going to bring my head of manufacturing in. He's one of the most sophisticated guys in manufacturing, literally on the planet, probably as sophisticated as anybody, because everything Mark did was automated. Manufacturing clothes at his scale is not about people with scissors. It's all about machines, automated. You know, everything is in it. You assemble this part here and bring it there and da-da-da. It's all sophisticated, all run by computers. And he says, yo, you can absolutely do that. So his head of manufacturing comes and says, oh, yeah. You can do it, and I'll show you how to do it. And next thing I know, he's working full-time for us. He's our COO now, and he brings in his top guys. And this is a tribute to John. Only John could do this. From ground zero, we went to a plant that can deliver 2 million units a year. And by the way, we can scale it to 10 million units in about 6 months, in 5 months. And we fully automated it. You know, I was kind of laughing at myself when I saw that video, because that video was the old factory.
Yeah.
That video had a lot of people doing things by hand that are now done by machines. We have very few people doing things by machine. But that was a combination of, you know, luck. And also, the most complicated part of the manufacturing process is what they call stringing, which is soldering the metal you see here to these, and there was no automated stringer. We were going to have to build our own. And as Howard was looking at the plant saying, I can do this, a company in Italy announced that they made a micro stringer. They had no customers. They just made it in case someone needed one.
They said they could make it.
Yeah.
We didn't know if it could be made.
Yeah. Turns out they did make it, and we're their customer, and they're making it for us. And actually, they fell in love with the company, and they built a number of machines. We're not paying for them on spec that they're holding for. As soon as we need them, they can deliver them so they can keep the flow going. So it's a combination of some luck, but you know, some karma, and also, I guess, our stubbornness trying to figure a way to do this. So now we're actually literally manufacturing in Colorado.
Yeah, we're manufacturing in Colorado for African consumers. Can you believe that? Now that is business
not usual.
That is a perfect point on which to ask students if they have questions. You've got a mic. Is there a mic over here?
Hi, my name is Nicole, and this is really awesome what you guys are doing. What I want to know is if you've actually seen, like, because so there's definitely going to be a shift once you get these things into the hands of people who kind of live in these areas. Their whole quality of life is going to change. Like he was saying, they're not building schools that fast, but ultimately this is going to empower them too. So have you noticed anything tied to that? And then, of course, my second question is, can I buy one tonight?
Well, keep in mind, we only launched 2 weeks ago.
My response to this is, I went to a village in Kasisi Village in Zambia, and I went there about a year and a half ago, and I walked into the village and said, How many phones are here? And 45 people came to see me at the village, and there were 45 phones. And only five of them had energy in them, 40 dead phones. So I said, we're here to charge your phones today, and we were charging phones with the World Panel Generation 1. And we charged phones all day long. At the end of the day, you know, I was told, you know, don't leave any panels behind, but I couldn't help it, so I left 12 panels. And I left, and I said, you guys take the panels. And I just left, and I didn't think about what I should have done was measure it, but I went back a year later, and everybody had a brand new phone, and everybody had brand new shoes, and they were building a grocery store in the village that had, it was the size of a trailer. I mean, I couldn't believe it, and they paid for the materials, they paid for the mortar, they paid for the bricks, they paid for the roofing, and there was one guy in there named Simon. He was a real industrious guy, and you know, he was a millennial, and he bought a smartphone, and he started taking orders from other villages around, and he'd call the main city, and a delivery truck would come out to the bush, dump off these pallets, and he would sell all this merchandise, and he was making bank. And so the only difference, and I walked back to the village a year later, and I'm like, hi, I'm back. Who needs their phones charged? And they're like, are you kidding me? We don't need our phones charged. Can you sell us more stuff, you know? So I'm like, you guys all have money? They had never made that much on the tomato harvest, never made that much on the onion harvest, never made that much on the maize. Everyone had jobs. Everyone had education opportunities and health care. They were actually listening to Katy Perry, okay? And they were streaming music in the village and dancing. You saw the dancing on there? That's them dancing. So it's just phenomenal. I didn't measure the economic impact. And by the way, there was no carbon in that village, no generator, no electricity, no carbon, but everyone had their power. And I think that's the goodwill that can happen around the world.
Hey, thank you so much for coming. I had two questions. One was, you mentioned a little bit about the patent you have on it and why you didn't want to work with manufacturers in China. But is this something that people can sort of take and reverse engineer and sort of figure out? And if that does happen where someone is using this sort of technology, is that going to work? Right, is that going to work in the international market?
Why are we going to come and get you? Okay? No, the answer to that question is, it's hard to reverse engineer even after reading the patent because there's some secret sauce that's not in there. But I believe anything can be reverse engineered.
I don't think you can reverse engineer. Yeah. This is like an 80-page, look at this, 80-page. Yeah.
It's hard, but you have enough money and enough people and enough engineers, and you buy a bunch of panels, which you'll be able to do. There's some secret sauce in there that you can't just read in there, so which we're not going to tell you, obviously. But it's hard to reverse engineer, but I think ultimately other people will be able to engineer it. Now, we have a patent treaty with China. We have a patent treaty with Europe. Patents in China don't mean a whole lot, you know. Good luck suing a Chinese company in China. The only one I've seen that was actually able to control what he did in China was Steve, because he had so much leverage with the factories. But I'll just tell you a true story, what it's like doing business in China in addressing this issue. Samsung built a big plant in China. When I say big, we're talking about $600-700 million plant in China. The guy who was in charge of the whole plant, the minute the plant was finished, quit. He went 10 miles down the road, and he built another slightly better plant for the biggest Chinese phone company. All the technology,
all this stuff was in that, what's the name of that, Y phones? It's in those phones now. So can somebody do this? Yeah, probably. It'll take them a while. But our job now is to try to scale this. See, in the software business, it's much, much different. You know, they talked about in software blitz scaling. That's what you do. And you try to capture an area. You take 150 million, 200 million, you throw at it, and boom, 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 boom. Now you're Facebook, you got that whole sector. Now you're Uber, now you're whoever, right? You can't do that with hardware. You got to build the plants. You got to build the machines to do this. It's not so easy. It's not like software. With software, you can backward engineer it. The one thing I do know is you can backward engineer pretty much any software if you have the right people. So this is not easy to pirate. Can it be pirated? Yeah, sometimes, yeah. That's one of our legitimate concerns. But what we want to do is keep innovating the products, the brand. Since most of the stuff out of China we know doesn't work. In fact, none of it works, really. And try to make a brand where people will pay for the brand. And I think you know, making in the USA actually means something less here than it does overseas. It says made in USA overseas means it's a quality product.
Yeah.
Also, if you're partnering with the carriers,
we're going
to
part.
The lawyers to say you're going to use. Oh, no.
No, that's right. No, we're literally partnering in Africa with the most powerful companies in Africa. You know, the biggest retailer, biggest phone company. These guys get a lot of juice. So, and it behooves them not to have some crummy product that someone's trying to, you know, counterfeit it.
Skip, John, my name's Connor. Thank you so much for being here. I mean, you guys are changing the world. It's absolutely unbelievable that you've created solar technology for less than $20 for people. I'm blown away. I'd like to hear more about your manufacturing process. Like, is it sustainable? Because that's one of the biggest issues with photovoltaic production nowadays is it's not carbon zero because the manufacturing process itself with silicon and everything else, you have a lot of byproducts that are harmful for the environment. So I want to hear about your manufacturing process and is that sustainable?
It's a good question. I mean, the dirty little secret in renewable energies is solar is not a clean industry, right? There's a lot of fluorocarbons, unfortunately. And so, you know, you're right. You put up a gigawatt of solar, how much does energy you have to create in order to offset the waste, right? So it's definitely something to consider, you know. How are we dealing with it is, we're not using traditional solar materials, we're using legacy materials. And the other thing, too, is that because we charge devices, phones, GoPros, Garmins, you know, things like this, that take a lot of carbon just to keep one charge is a half a pound of carbon. That's a lot of carbon to keep your phones charged. All of you have a half a pound of carbon in your phone or more. If you have a 3,000 milliamp battery, you got more than a half a pound of carbon. So because we're Pac-Man at heavy carbon density, then we can recapture quickly. But if we're just generating electricity like what David talked about at a utility farm, and we're driving everything into the grid after we invert it all into AC, then drive it into the grid, then drive it miles down, and then drive it to your wall plug, you don't have as much efficiency in the carbon capture. So I believe that we're addressing that issue.
Great. Thank you.
That takes to create it. That's right.
So embedded energy, yeah. If you use it every day, you know, and use it consistently, then, you know, 100 charges, you're like, okay, that's 50 pounds of carbon.
This is designed to last 20 years.
And it's cool. Go ahead.
Well, thank you both for so much for coming in today. But I was just wondering if, John, if you ever had a moment where you felt like you, like on maybe the 89th iteration or the 100th iteration of the product, where you just felt like maybe you wanted to give up, and like how did you get past that and keep going? Like what motivated you?
You know, you're exactly right. I had 2 weeks of those 2 years, right, they were really dark weeks where I was like, I don't know if I can do this. But I was, during those 2 weeks, I had some friends, because I actually was going to quit. I didn't ever tell you this.
You never did. Thank God.
Like, I
I can't do this. I'm going to. And then I had another really nice job offer, you know, like, you can come and run our company, make a whole bunch of money, and you don't have to do this. And so I started writing this business plan for this other business, and I was going to do something else. And I had a close friend of mine who said, well, so what are you going to do with World Panel then? And I couldn't answer it. I'm like, well, I can't get rid of it. It's part of my identity. And the other thing, too, is I just couldn't turn my back on Beatrice, you know, and all the ladies that you saw raise their hands. Look, these are widows in Uganda. There are about 250,000 of them live in this small town called Sarati, and their husbands are dead from war or HIV. And they were oracles, I think, of the world because they could see what they needed, and I think that's what we all need under this basic view of life. And so what kept me going was fear. Fear of failure, fear of not finding out who I was, fear. It was a lot of fear-driven. Those weeks where I was really fearful that I wouldn't live up to what I was born to do. And I think that my friend said, welcome fear. Welcome. Bring it on. And I think those were the moments that were what helped me get going was friends.
But I also think, knowing John as I do now, he had a sense of mission. This was not about business. This was not about anything else. He felt he was born to do this. And he was driven to do it. And nothing was going to stop him. And I've seen this in the last 2 years as we've gone through various things over and over and over. He will not be stopped. He just keeps plugging along. When we said, okay, let's put this factory up, nobody puts up a fully automated factory to manufacture something in 5 months. You can't really do that. A number of the machines we basically created.
We invented the robots.
Yeah. Built the algorithms to control the robots. Nobody does that. I mean, you have to be insane to do that.
We only had one engineer on staff, everybody. One guy with an engineering degree. Every other person that worked for the company was a tradesman. Okay, they came out of the trades. They were in glass, they were in framing, they were in construction, but they were real hands-on engineer guys, welders, you know, and we couldn't afford high-priced engineers, so we hired a lot of tradesmen.
Yeah, his partner that you saw in the garage is named Matt, and he's like MacGyver.
Yeah,
I mean, whatever he is, swear to God, whatever, I was there with him, whatever thing you have, he's, oh yeah, I can figure it out, we can do this, da 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 da. Then next thing you know, you see this robotic arm do this.
I know.
You know, tradesmen are not common anymore. You know, one of the biggest problems I think that your generation has going forward is, you know, clearly we've moved into service economy, right? Everybody knows that. But what most people aren't thinking about is what I see in tech now is everything about neural networks, about AI, about thinking machines that think better, faster, do things better than humans. If you are in that area in any university, you got a job, a high-paying job. I know some universities, I know this because most of them I'm doing, have been just stripped of every student that knows anything about neural networks. That's great for certain companies in terms of lowering their costs and eliminating human labor, but it eliminates more manual labor, certainly unskilled labor, and it also eliminates even more skilled labor, more programmers and other stuff, because these machines are going to do it. And I think one of the things your generation faces is, what are you going to do? How are you going to find a job, find your way, given that? And I wish I had an answer for you, but I don't.
Hi, John and Skip. Thank you so much for spending time with us tonight. My name is Roger, and I was wondering, with all the competition later on that's probably going to, you know, come soon since you've just launched, and they see that this is, you know, renewable energy and they're going to start competing with you, have you ever, like, considered a version 2 already, or a version 3 or version 4? And my second question is, what can we do as students to help you? Thank you.
The answer is, we're already working on we have some engineers developing new products, and we're iterating all the time. But what you have to understand about John is,
we're always iterating. You know, I wish I had, I could show you all of the different panels we had till we got to this one. But we're iterating, you know, fold out panel with a band rate built in that's faster than a wall plug. We're iterating, you can actually take one of our devices, you could build it in the back of your iPad or computer, and it's faster than a wall plug. So anytime you're in any light, you're charging your computer. You got a top secret. Oh yeah, you know we have
new products.
New products. So the answer is, you can never stand. See, I have a theory about learning, but it's also the same thing about business. You're either going up, you're going down. If you're standing still, you're going down. So you always got to be going up. You also got to be iterating, learning, and try to do things better. You can never say, oh, this is good enough. Let's not try to make it better. One thing I love about John is that he absolutely embraces that philosophy. Whenever I call him up with some idea or something, he doesn't say, I don't have time for that. He says, yeah, this is what we're going to do, you know, and we figure a way to do it. So we're always, I mean, we have, I don't even know how many projects going right now, but we have a whole bunch of projects going both in the marketing, social network. We're doing all this testing. We're developing new products that we think will have more appeal in a place like the U.S. You know, you don't need this big heavy thing that's indestructible in the U.S. My daughter's on her 11th iPhone, you know. People are willing to pay to get a new one. They want a light thing that's more powerful, you know. Or also, you don't have to make it as cheap, so you can use Gorilla Glass that's truly indestructible and use different materials and build something that's indestructible, but it costs more. You can charge more. So the answer is, yeah, we're always thinking about that. I think what you as students can do is get the word out that it's a good thing to have mobile cellular power.
This here is a 1 amp panel. This is 1 amp, okay? This is as powerful as this, okay? This is full of coal, this is sun, okay? So this one here,
it's actually more powerful. You can charge your iPhone an hour quicker than this.
iPhone 6 Plus charges an hour and a half faster on this.
Faster on this than it does a wall plug.
Yeah. So if you have this, you can have one for you and one for your girlfriend.
Or your Tinder friend, whoever it is.
Keep in mind that there are students from so many countries at USC. This is the most internationally diverse country. Mm-hmm.
One thing I have to do is I have to show you something. I need my volunteer. You want to volunteer? Okay.
Natalie's back.
So you're gonna make some big bucks. I need another volunteer. I need one more volunteer. Okay, come on up. So you hold this.
Okay.
Okay. And you hold this. Okay. And you hold this. Okay. So basically, if you take electronics. And they all have circuit boards, right? So all electronics have circuit boards. Okay. What happens when the circuit board gets wet? Gone, right? Okay, can you move over here just a little bit? Okay. So if we take water and we put circuits in the water, what happens? They're gone, right? So you saw that this makes energy right here. What happens if you put it into water? Ports open. You want to run it? Okay. So is it underwater?
Yes.
Okay. Is it totally underwater? Can you shake it around?
Yes.
Okay. Now you can let go. Leave it in there. Okay. Just hold it with both hands there, dear. Okay. Now here, you take this light. And you plug this in. Can we make electricity underwater? Or are we going to shock ourselves, huh? So I'm going to try and plug this in underwater. Now put your hand over it.
Amanda, you get to keep the water.
You see, this thing makes electricity underwater. And this is what the customers need.
Something that's durable.
Or they drop their panel in the canoe and the water fishing gets wet, gets rainy, gets dirty, gets dusty. So this thing literally works underwater. And this is part of the technology breakthrough. So no one in the world can generate electricity underwater except the World Panel. One of the inventions. You need to set that down for the world.
I asked, like, today, are you going to do a demo? He's like, oh, yeah. We just need water. I'm like, I need to see this thing work. That's
I also have one other thing here is to show you that we make them in pink.
For breast cancer awareness.
Well, you know why they make them pink? Because in Africa, the men will take the panels away from the women.
Yeah. If the ladies have this one, the guys will take it, but the guys will not touch pink in Africa.
They won't be seen with a pink panel.
So I made a pink panel for the lady. And they're really cool.
Now this panel, this is a,
I made this,
this is a one of a kind series.
I made this.
For this class, for USC?
Yeah.
So you saw, this is so legit. So, you know, Skip made his comment before about, you know.
Your colors.
I'll just sort of ask Skip a pretty basic question. So the chairman of UCLA's fundraising campaign is Anthony Pritzker. Where does his daughter go to school? I forget. Here. Hold on. We're not done. So the head coach
and
of UCLA.
And I came here for
hold
this.
Hold on. The head coach of UCLA football.
I came here
football,
to be used to be told.
The head coach of UCLA football is Jim Mora. You'd think, you know, his daughter would be able to go to school at UCLA for free, I would assume. Where does she go to school? Here. And Skip's youngest daughter. He went to UCLA. His wife went to UCLA. What did you tell me right before class? Where does she want to go to school?
I'm not going to tell you. It's a secret.
He wants to step over my punchline, but he can say all he wants. Everybody wants to be here for a reason. Let's thank Skip Brittenham and John Anderson.